Good morning. My name is Steve Wyatt. I'm Jack's reporter and co-producer. Some of you may remember me. Jack won't be here for a couple of days. Sadly, his wife died last night of a lengthy illness. So he'll be taking a few days off. We'll update you as much as we can about how Jack is doing and his family. In the meantime, Mark Schneider, Jack's reporter as well, and I are going to be here for today at least, trying to conduct Jack's interviews as best we can. And in that order, we have Ted Carmichael here today. He's the senior policy advisor for the CD Howe Institute. He's going to tell us about the failing Canadian dollar. This morning, as a matter of fact, it dropped down below 72 cents for the first time. And Mark, who else have we got?
Steve, we have Mel Hurtig. I don't know if you remember, last time Mel was on, he was selling his own brand of Canadian Encyclopedia. Today, he's in town trying to sell Canadian nationalism. Is nationalism dead? Mel Hurtig in a moment.
Sounds like the early 70s all over again.
We'll see.
And then we also have Heather Bird, who's written a book called Not Above the Law about that incredible murder story involving Colin Thatcher, the former energy minister in Saskatchewan, and his conviction for the murder of his wife, Joanne Wilson. We'll be back with Ted Carmichael after the break. Well, the downward spiral of our poor old dollar continues to fall, and this morning we hear over the wire that it dropped to 71.79 cents below that incredible American dollar. Ted Carmichael's here to tell us what does that mean to us all? I mean, should we worry about that?
Well, I think everyone around the world is worrying about the strength of the United States dollar, not so much because of the dollar itself, but because of what it's doing to interest rates in countries like Canada and Europe and Japan. When the U.S. dollar is very strong. Here in Canada, we're trying to cushion the drop in the Canadian dollar. And the way we're doing that is we're pushing up interest rates.
But does that really help? It seems we've gone through this so many times before. People panic about interest rates. I mean, how can we afford anything under a situation like that if they continue to go up again to 20% like they did a few years ago?
Well, I don't think they're heading up to 20%. I don't think that the fundamentals in the economy are suggesting that that borrowing is that strong to push interest rates that high again. But there's really only one way, I think, that the strength of the dollar and this rise in interest rates is going to come to an end. It's either going to come to an end by a slowdown in the growth rate of the U.S. economy. The U.S. economy has been growing very rapidly. We had news yesterday that there was an upward revision in the growth rate in the fourth quarter to almost 5%. Many economists are expecting similar growth in the first quarter.
Compared to what Canadian growth? What is ours growing?
Our growth right now is more in the 2-3% range. So either growth in the U.S. economy has to slow down or some action has to be taken to bring down the U.S. deficit. Those are the two main sources of pressure on interest rates and on the U.S. dollar.
Ronald Reagan, of course, has based his political future on bringing down the deficit. Can that be done? Can he buy his way out of a deficit?
Whether he can buy his way out of it, I'm not sure, but I think definitely the U.S. deficit can be brought down. A big political battle is brewing.
But the casualties are there. It's the rest of the Western world, isn't it?
Well, the casualties is the rest of the Western world as long as there's no action there. But as soon as there is action, I think we'll see some easing up of pressure on the U.S. dollars.
Ted, I know that there's been some talk about reducing the Canadian deficit. Do you see that as a problem that the Tories are actually willing to undertake right now? And do you think they should? Do you think we should see some federal restraint program a la Bill Bennett's restraint program in B.C.?
Well, I think definitely that 1985 is the year that the Canadian government has to start acting to reduce the $36 billion deficit in Canada. The public debt in Canada is now growing at a rate in excess of 20%, 24%. The economy is growing at 10%. What that's doing is pushing up the interest payments that the federal government is having to make on its debt each year, and that is squeezing the amount of money that's left over to spend on social programs and other worthwhile types of government expenditures. Somehow or other, we got to slow down the rate of growth of that debt. There's really only two ways of going about that. One way is trimming back expenditures. The other way is raising taxes. Right now, the economy can't afford an increase in taxes.
So I assume, obviously, that you're recommending more reductions in federal spending.
What we're really recommending is a slowdown in the rate of growth of spending over the next 5 years. We've had a lot of discussion since November about social programs and other types of ways of cutting the deficit. And in many cases, there's been a great deal of confusion. It's looked like the government has closed off a number of options for how it might cut the deficit. In fact, we think that there's one major option that's left, and that option is on many of the programs that are indexed to the rate of inflation, that indexation factor be cut back, that we no longer use the actual rate of inflation, but we use something far less, maybe zero.
What, you're talking about pensions?
Well, we're talking about pensions, we're talking about family allowances, we're talking about unemployment insurance, and we're also talking about the indexation that takes place in the tax system, in personal taxes. I think you'd have to do it across the board. There would be a certain rough justice in that. Everyone wouldn't like it, there's no question about that, but it would be seen, I think, as a fairly broadly based and even-handed approach.
Let's take a look at our national bankbook just for a second. How much money do we owe as a nation?
Well, there's several ways of looking at that. One of the ways that we've been looking at it is how much does the federal government owe? What's the federal public debt? Right now, it's $190 billion. And what that's saying is that since Confederation, the federal government has borrowed a total of $190 billion. Its spending has been in excess of its revenues by that much. The projections that we have for federal deficits over the next 5 years suggest that we'll be adding something between $35 and $40 billion in borrowing each year. In other words, over the next 5 years, we're going to add as much to the federal public debt
as we did in all our history.
As we have in history since Confederation. So that's one way of looking at what we owe. The other way of looking at it is what we owe to foreigners. Most of what the federal government owes, it borrows from Canadians, Canada savings bonds, treasury bills, that kind of thing, safe investments. But by chewing up most of Canadian savings, that means that Canadian corporations, provincial governments, provincial crown corporations have to go abroad. We have $100 billion in foreign debt, and that foreign debt becomes more expensive to pay the interest on or to repay every time the Canadian dollar goes down. So we have to be concerned about that as well.
So in terms of everybody out there, we have a great huge principal debt out there, and all we're doing now is trying to keep ahead of the interest payments.
That's certainly true, and the only way really, particularly on the federal side, to bring that down is to curtail the growth
expenses.
Of spending. That's right.
But you know, what I hear you saying, and I think what's going to shock a lot of people, is that what we've seen right now in these modest Tory efforts at restraining costs, we saw the Tories back down completely on their sanctity
right.
of social programs and their sacred trust. Do you think that the Tories actually have the will, the political will, to carry out this program? It sounds pretty brutal.
Well, I think that the opinion on that has been shifting back and forth. There's no question that over the last month or two, there's been a real pessimism that Michael Wilson was going to get the support of the Prime Minister and the Cabinet in bringing about the kind of expenditure restraint that's necessary to start doing something about the deficit. I think some sober second thought is going on right now. People are looking more carefully at the options that haven't been closed off and what the possibilities are. And the Prime Minister during that period has made some fairly forceful statements suggesting that the deficit is a very high priority for the government. So we're all still guessing. We won't know until the budget comes out. But when it does come out, and if it doesn't come up with the kind of action that we think is required, I think one of the consequences will be Canada will continue to be vulnerable to these kinds of drops in the Canadian dollar and pushing up of interest rates.
When they came out with that discussion paper a little while ago, the anticipation was that there was going to be a real tough position taken by the government. They're really going to tackle this deficit and really get our house in order. And yet when this thing came out, it went over like a lead balloon. I mean, what did that do to our perception in other countries of our leadership in this country? Are we now perceived as a strong government right now?
Well, I think that whenever there appears to be indecision on the part of the government, whenever it looks like they can't make up their mind about what they want to do, that creates in foreign markets or with investors the idea that Canada maybe isn't a great place to invest until they get their act sorted out and until they decide exactly what they want to do. Now, I think that the indecisiveness that was suggested in that paper gave a lot of credibility to that view.
What about interest rates now? Is this going to be another continuing spiral, do you think? Can our economy and can the public, you know, anticipation or anxiety about interest rates, can we deal with that again, another bout?
Well, again, the pressure on interest rates is coming almost entirely from the United States. And there, it's either going to be a matter of something getting done on the deficit in the United States, and there, I would say that you're not going to see anything done within the next 3 to 6 months. There's going to be a pitched political battle between members of Congress and the Reagan administration. When the smoke clears, I think late in the summer, they're going to come up with a $50 billion reduction in their deficit. But I think it's a cause of uncertainty right now. So if that continues, and if the U.S. economy continues to grow, then we're in for pressure on the Canadian dollar and on interest rates for some time to come. It's going to make it tough for Michael Wilson when he comes to make his budget in May if this continues.
Okay. More on interest rates, the Canadian dollar, our future, with Ted Carmichael, and your calls too if you can help Mark and I out after the break. We learn now that the Canadian dollar is springing back just a little. It's gone up over 72 cents again. However, we've got $36 billion deficit right now. What do we do? What specifically can we do to bring it down and restore some confidence in the country?
Well, in a report that we issued earlier this week, we've recommended that by the end of the decade, the government try to cut $15 to $20 billion off of this deficit that we've got right now. The reason we've picked that number is goes back to what I was talking about in terms of the public debt and the rate of growth of the public debt. We feel that if you cut it in half, basically, cut the deficit in half, that growth of the debt that you would still have, because you'd still have $15 or $20 billion a year deficits, would be manageable. The debt would be growing at about the same rate as the economy. Okay, that's the target, $15 to $20 billion.
By what year again?
By the end of the decade.
Right, okay.
We've also said that we think that action is needed, significant action is needed in the first year. So we're looking for $5 billion out of that in the first budget.
So where is that going to come from?
Okay, now that's the big question. Where are we going to make these savings? First of all, in November, the Minister of Finance focused on the expenditure side of the budget. He said that he was making a commitment to Canadians that he would slow down or cut the rate of growth of expenditures by $10 to $15 billion by the end of the decade. In our view, this is a very good first step, that expenditures are the place to look first. We have a new government in place. They have to convince themselves that the programs that were there when they got there are the kind of programs that they want to have. Mr. Nielsen's task force is looking program by program to determine whether that's the case. They're floating trial balloons to see whether or not cuts in certain areas will fly or won't fly. In many cases, they're finding that they won't.
What about the public service?
But okay, now there, what we're saying is, if you're going to get $10 to $15 billion in cuts in federal spending, you can't rule out any area of spending. So first of all, you've got to look at economic development spending. There's about $15 billion in that area. One of the biggest categories is the petroleum incentive payments, PIP grants, about $2 billion. Almost everyone agrees that those ought to be cut back, perhaps eliminated. So that's one big area. There's industrial and regional development programs worth about $2 billion. They've already been trimmed in November, but they could stand some further trimming. We think that perhaps over a five-year period, a couple of billion dollars could come out of those kind of programs. After that, defense and foreign aid. Well, defense, we've got commitments on defense. And if
Should we have bought the new uniforms?
It's a small amount compared to what we're talking about. In the area of defense, we've got commitments, and we know that the government wants, if anything, to build up spending in that area. Mm-hmm. And foreign aid, this is not the time to be cutting foreign aid. People around the world are seeing the drought and famine problems.
But how can the government
It's not an area to cut. Yeah. Okay, so this is an area of another $10 or $12 billion that is almost off limits. Mm-hmm. So what else is there? Well, there is just the operation of governments. Right. There's civil servants, paychecks, there's government operating costs.
Well, that brings up something. The Fed's tried the 6 and 5 program. Do you think that we will see, under the federal Tories, a new effort to cap wages, at least in the private or the public sector? Do you think they're going to go after that? And if you think they do, what do you think how they'll do it?
Okay, I think they will do it, and I think it'll be part of a broader strategy that will also deal with social programs, which is the one thing that was left on my list, mm-hmm. and accounts for about 45% of total spending.
Almost half of total spending.
Yeah. So what I think is going to happen there, and I think it will affect civil servants' wages, is that instead of giving an annual increase of 4% or 5% in line with the rate of inflation, it'll be something far less than that. It'll be zero, or it'll be 3% below the rate of inflation. So public sector wages, instead of going up by 4 or 5%, 1 or 2%. index pensions instead of going up by 5%, 1 or 2%.
This has
unemployment insurance, all of these things. Now, what that would do, what is attractive about this, is that anyone that's receiving a government check, whether you're a government employee or you're receiving a transfer payment, you'd still continue to receive the check. The check wouldn't be cut back in size, but it just wouldn't grow as fast over the next 5 years. And there are big, big savings that could be made.
And therefore, universality could be protected, I guess, as well.
Yeah, universality could be protected. In fact, a lot of that debate about universality was beside the point.
But it's a hot political issue. I mean, the family allowances, old age pensions, all that sort of thing.
There's going to be screams of outrage.
Of agony.
I mean, if the government's prepared to do a tenth of what you want them to do, we'll have the grannies out in the street if you're going to go after their pensions.
Can they sell it politically?
No, I don't think that that's the case. I think that, in fact, Canadians are quite prepared to shoulder a share of reducing this deficit if they feel that they're not doing it, that it's not concentrated on them. If they feel it's across the board, if they feel that industry is doing it, that upper income individuals are doing it, and everyone is doing it, then I think that...
You're familiar somewhat with the British Columbia restraint program. We've gone through 3 years of restraint now, and the very word is conjures up visions, and this sounds like deja vu that we're going through this.
Doesn't this also bring back the specter of the anti-inflation board and public sector unions marching out in the street? I mean, what you could risk, in fact, is tremendous social unrest, it seems, which could be just as costly as reducing the budget.
Let's go back to the 6 and 5 program that you mentioned before. I think that many people in the private sector, looking back on the situation, would have been very happy to have gotten 6 and 5 in those 2 years. In fact, public sector wages have been rising faster than private sector wages over the past couple of years. And that's been under a period of restraint. I'm not saying that's been the case in British Columbia. British Columbia was a different case.
And you think it's gone well here?
Well, I would say that that's not the way the federal government ought to go. It doesn't have to be big cuts in the existing amount of spending that's going on. What it has to be is a very substantial slowdown in the growth of that spending.
How does our deficit compare to the American one? We have $36 billion deficit. The American deficit is how much?
$250 billion right now, isn't
it? No, $220, and if nothing is done there, it'll be $300 by the end of the decade. But on a per capita basis...
Ours is worse.
Ours is much higher than theirs. Our deficit is about $1,400 for every man, woman, and child in Canada.
It seems like such an insurmountable amount of money to the average Joe sitting out there, the working stiff, or the unemployed stiff. Why should he worry about this right now when he's trying to feed his own family?
It's a number that really you can't wrap your mind around.
Right.
Whether you've studied it or you haven't studied it, $36 billion is just an incredible amount of money.
But people do have mortgages, and they're worried about their own interest rates, aren't they?
They certainly are, and I think that the way that it affects the average person and the way that it will continue to affect them if nothing is done about it is, first of all, it's going to keep interest rates high. U.S. deficits are keeping international interest rates high. The Canadian deficit is keeping Canadian interest rates high relative to U.S. interest rates. So if the U.S. doesn't bring its deficit down, we're not going to have low interest rates. But we have to bring ours down as they bring theirs down if we want to benefit from lower interest rates internationally. That's one way. The other way is that the longer we wait with this problem, the more we let the debt pile up, the more we run $35 billion deficits year after year, the bigger that public debt becomes, the bigger the interest payments on the debt becomes, and the more severe the expenditure reductions or the tax increases that we're talking about will eventually have to be. Sooner or later, we're going to have to pay the piper on this thing, and if we pay it sooner, we'll have to pay less than if we leave it until later.
Okay, Ted, your call is to Ted Carmichael, Senior Policy Analyst for the CD Howe Institute, after the break. Ted Carmichael is the Senior Policy Analyst for the C.D. Howe Institute. What is the C.D. Howe Institute, first of all?
Well, it's a private, nonprofit research organization. We've got about 400 members across the country, and they make contributions to us because I think they believe that we do nonpartisan research and try to get to the bottom of some tough questions.
Where would you plant yourself on the spectrum of economic thinking, right or left?
Well, I think that the reason that people look forward to what we publish is because we're rather unpredictable in that sense. We don't put ourselves on the right or the left.
I see.
Can I ask you whether you think that Michael Wilson or Brian Mulroney listens to you?
I'm quite sure that they do. I have no doubt about it in my mind.
Before we go to phones, one question. Should Gerald Bowie, the governor of the Mega Canada, stay or go?
I think that he should stay. I think he's been doing an excellent job.
Okay, with that, we'll try the phones now. I've never done this before, so patience, please. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
I'd like to make a comment here that is, I think, very important, both to the politicians and the economists, since I'm in finance.
Can't hear.
Of Canada cannot affect the interest rates of Canada, neither can the governor of the Bank of Canada. And the reason is this, that our rates are set by what the financial intermediaries will bid on Treasury bills. Yeah. And since the Bank of Canada, hence the government, is the major borrower, rather than the major lender like they used to be, they cannot affect the interest rates. Now, the Act requires that on these Treasury bills, the Bank of Canada cannot bid below the lowest bid from the financial intermediaries.
He's saying that the bankers, the bad guys, isn't it?
The way they can affect the interest rate is by printing one hell of a pile of money, putting out more Treasury bills than they know will be bought, and then the Bank of Canada buying up the majority of those, and it can only shift the interest rates very, very lightly.
Okay, Mr. Carmichael?
I would agree with pretty much all of what the caller has said. The Bank of Canada really isn't controlling interest rates here in Canada. They're being controlled by the financial markets.
Wait a minute, didn't I just hear that they had raised the Bank of Canada interest rate half a point yesterday? Isn't that controlling it?
Well, they certainly did raise the Bank of Canada rate yesterday, but the thing is that rates are going up in the United States, rates are going up in Europe, rates are going up everywhere.
So it's the same
Bank of Canada can resist those upward movements in rates, but if they do so, we'll have a bigger drop in the dollar.
How long can the American dollar sustain this steamroller motion upwards?
Well, that's a hard one to call. Economists were saying almost for 2 years now that it would not be sustained.
Is there some way that we can prick their balloon? I mean, just sort of modestly let some of the air out of their economy? I mean, in a nice, gentlemanly way.
No, there really isn't. Their economy is growing very, very well because they've put together a mix of policies that are very conducive to growth. And they've convinced the whole world that that's true, and the economy is growing very well. At the same time, the government in the United States has not gotten out of the capital market. So the combination of the idea that there are good investment prospects in the United States in the private sector, plus huge borrowing requirements in the public sector, are going to continue to put upward pressure on rates.
Okay, go ahead, please.
Yes. I would like to ask Mr. Carmichael, how is it that in our foreign funds parts in the papers, the newspapers, there is nothing mentioned about the difference in currency between the U.S. and the Russian or the Eastern Bloc currencies?
Well, there's not much trading going on, is there?
Well, I don't know. There's a lot of wheat being sold. It doesn't matter. There's not. You mean to tell me that we don't have as much trade with Russia as we have with some of these other foreign funds that are listed in the paper?
Yeah, forget the United States for a minute. How do we rate the rest of the world and other monetaries?
Well, certainly the Canadian dollar over the past couple of years has been a strong currency internationally. It's been very strong relative to the European currencies, relative to the pound. I can't tell the caller exactly how it's been doing compared to the ruble. But one suspects that the strength of the U.S. dollar is a strength relative to the ruble as well as to the French franc and the English pound.
Maybe the caller is a collector of rubles right now, like trading in futures.
Go ahead, Victoria.
Question directed to Ted Carmichael regarding a twofold possibility interest rate, one that would induce foreign investment within our country, and also why not let our dollar slide and we will sell more exports and bring more revenue into the country?
Good question.
I'll hang up and listen
okay.
to your response. Thanks.
There's no question that a lower Canadian dollar boosts Canadian exports. Our recovery that we've had in the last couple of years has been almost entirely export-led. It's been because the U.S. economy has been strong, and it's because the U.S. dollar has been strong, the Canadian dollar has been weak. We can continue to have an export-led recovery as the Canadian dollar continues to fall. But there is a risk, and that is that as the Canadian dollar falls, it makes Canadian goods more and more competitive, along with other foreign goods, more and more competitive in U.S. markets. What that's doing in the United States is raising protectionist pressures. One type of protectionist pressure that everyone in BC knows about is the softwood lumber case.
Right.
As the Canadian dollar continues to fall, I think that that's going to increase those kind of pressures in the United States and lead to non-tariff barriers to trade, which I think is becoming a growing problem.
But you have to admit that when the Canadian dollar falls, it is inflationary, isn't it? I mean, we do have to pay for it. And, you know, it brings up the specter of maybe perhaps what we should do is have some kind of currency controls. Last night, our NewsHour ran a story saying a guy in Vancouver made almost $13,000 yesterday.
A speculator on the money markets.
Okay, I want to deal with both of those things because, first of all, the drop in the dollar does not necessarily have to be very inflationary. In the inflationary period of the late 1970s, when everything was going up, commodity prices, oil prices, everything, every time there was a drop in the Canadian dollar, it was very quickly passed through the whole structure of the Canadian economy, wages, prices, everything, and it boosted inflation. Right now, we've got over 11% unemployment. When that's the situation, when there's a lot of unused capacity in the Canadian economy, if you get a drop in the dollar, it doesn't pass through. Certainly, import prices go up, but it doesn't pass through in the same way. The second thing, currency controls, I think, is the worst possible solution to this kind of problem. It just creates more of an uncertainty about the management of the Canadian economy, leads foreign investors to want to keep their money out of this country, not in this country, and put more downward pressure on the Canadian dollar.
Okay, go ahead from Kamloops.
Yes, I was very interested in your program and what you have to say. There are a few questions I have. You know, you mentioned the crowding out situation with the government debt, crowding out private investment, you know, but at the same time with the tax dividend credit we have in this country, you can achieve just about the same return or maybe even better on your money through common stock dividends and also get into the capital gains prospect. So how do you feel, what effect do you think that has?
Well, I think a Canadian investor can do that, but I don't think that a foreign investor has the same ability to take advantage of Canadian tax laws that way. And part of the problem that we're having right now is that the U.S. is the attractive looking place to invest. Foreigners are investing in the U.S., they're not investing in Canada. And Canadians are even looking to the U.S. because A, they're seeing that there are good rates of return in the U.S., and B, if they think that the Canadian dollar is going to continue to fall, they can get a gain on the foreign exchange as well.
Okay. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I've been holding on for some time. Perhaps my questions have been answered. But like millions of other Canadians, the more we try to understand, the less we know. I was just wondering, since our dollar took such a sharp drop in the last couple of days, why would Canadians or money go out of the country to invest at a higher interest rate? This is one of the arguments I hear. If our Canadian, if there's such a large discount on the dollar, and then on top of that, the investor would have to get an interest payment on top of that. Now, why would that help him? Now, if somebody could show us what happened in the last couple of days in the dollar exchange, who actually was selling these dollars or buying just for those 2 days.
So it was a quick lesson on what's happening with the dollar.
In the short term, everything in these markets is being driven by expectation. Where is the Canadian dollar going to be in a week's time? How strongly is the Bank of Canada going to resist the fall in the Canadian dollar? If people believe that they're not going to resist it very strongly, then Canadian companies, or American companies for that matter, that transfer funds back and forth across the border, and that are going to be needing American funds sometime in the next couple of months, are saying, well, we're going to transfer our Canadian dollars or exchange our Canadian dollars today rather than waiting for a week. To American dollars, because if we wait a week, we'll get a lot less American dollars at that time.
You know, I can see a company which may have to buy something from the United States wanting to do it right now before things get too expensive. But isn't there something a bit disloyal in somebody who just merely trades on Canadian money, you know, from moment to moment, perhaps
making... There's no morality in money markets.
I think you're exactly right, that loyalty really doesn't come into it. That investors are seeking the best rate of return that they can, whether it's for themselves or for their clients or whatever. That's what they're in business to do. And I think that less and less do national borders have any impact on the flow of capital around the world.
One last question. Are we coming out of the depths of recession or whatever it is we've been going through these last few years? Is there a light at the end of the tunnel?
There is a light at the end of the tunnel, but it's only there if we take some kind of tough decisions in 1985. And the primary one on the list, I think, is tackling the deficit.
I've got one last question, too. Do you think Canadian nationalism is dead? I've got a reason for asking this.
No, I don't think Canadian nationalism is dead, and I think it would be wrong to assume on the basis of the pressures that we're getting from the United States right now that that means anything of the kind.
Thanks, Mr. Carmichael, very much for coming, and thank you for your patience with the two amateurs.
It's been a real pleasure for me.
Okay, thanks. We'll be back with more about Canadian nationalism with Mel Hurtig, a champion of Canadian nationalism and a publisher, after the break.
Some of you may remember back in the heady days when Canada was full of vim and vigor and really was feeling its oats. This guy, Mel Hurtig, was around yelling that the sky was falling, being a real Chicken Little about Canadian nationalism back in the late 60s and early 70s. And you're back again telling us that the sky is falling again, is that right?
Well, it's really interesting. At that time, foreign ownership in Canada was going uphill on a graph mark that looked like this. And every day, there were more and more Canadian businesses disappearing. Every day, American companies and companies from Germany and Hong Kong and Japan were coming in and buying up our country. And we said, hey, we got to do something about
that. What's wrong with that? That sounds great.
Well, do you have children? Do you have
sure.
any kids? Okay, what would...
But my children also hoping that they could get some jobs, and maybe if we had a bit of investment right now, we'd get those jobs.
With that kind of policy and the kind of policies that the C.D. Howe Institute and the Conference Board talk about all the time, what would happen is that very simply your kids would have the wonderful benefit, Mark, of growing up as tenants in their own country. That's the best they would be. They would end up being tenants in a country that should have belonged to themselves. No other country in the world would sell themselves out the way we Canadians used to do in the past.
What's your impression of Brian Mulroney's recent visit to New York, then?
Well, Mr. Mulroney said very simply that Canada is open for business again. Here we are, guys. We investigated the fact that maybe we shouldn't be selling out our own country, and we said maybe there are better policies and there are better ideas, and maybe we should look to the idea that Canadian businessmen, small and medium-sized businessmen across the country from Halifax to Victoria, from St. John's to Victoria, should have the opportunity to have investment funds from Canadian banks. And Brian Mulroney says all over, and this is why we're starting a brand new organization, and we'll have a meeting here tonight in Vancouver. Mm-hmm. Brian Mulroney is saying, come on in, guys. We are open for business. It's like the slogan on the used car lots, and the used car lot slogan says, come in, no reasonable offer will ever be refused. And that's what he's saying.
But don't we need jobs. I mean, that's the reality right now.
I'm glad you raised that subject. Let me give you an example of the kind of thing I'll be talking about this evening. Here is a graph of what the Canadian computer industry looks like. It's going to be a $9 billion industry this year in 1985. The Canadian computer industry is dominated by big foreign companies. The Canadian independent computer servicing industry just said the other day that we have already lost, are you ready, 150,000 jobs for Canadians that should have been done here in this country to the United States because of the ownership of the computer industry. As the computer industry in Canada has grown like this, jobs in Canada have gone like this. We actually will have fewer jobs this year than we did 4 years ago.
But we also have less made in Canada jobs as well at the same time. Listen, what I'd like to do is back up. You were once the founder, chief Pasha of the Committee for an Independent Canada.
I was one of the founding members. Well,
whatever happened to that anyway?
Look, when we started in 1970, as I mentioned before, foreign ownership was going up every year. It was 37% of the Canadian economy. And you'll say, hey, what's so bad about that? And I'll say, well, compared to who? 1% in Japan, 2% in the United States, 2% in Great Britain, 3% in France. Again, it was the magnitude. There's nothing wrong with a little bit of foreign investment properly managed. There's nothing wrong with joint ventures. So we said, we've got to do something about that. When we folded our doors in 1981, foreign ownership was down to 27%. Now, Mr. Mulroney, with his free trade policies, with his open the door wide policies, with his cozying up to the Yanks in terms of Star Wars, if we go the route that he and his colleagues are suggesting, there's a very simple answer to all of the people listening to this show. There's just simply not going to be a Canada left down the road if we go that route.
Isn't that overstating it just a little bit?
Well, let me put it...
I mean, surely Canada is not dependent upon who goes into business here. Surely there's more to a Canadian identity. Even after the work you people did back in the early 70s, we have at least established some kind of sense of what Canada is, more so than just the bottom line, the profit line, who's in business
here. Yeah, I thought we decided who we were already, that we were quite boring people.
We're not quite boring people. We're fascinating, interesting people. We've got super writers. We've got super filmmakers. We've got super people in the arts. We're actually a damn interesting people. We need a little bit more self-confidence. That's what we need.
Steve, did he answer my question when I asked him whatever happened to the old Committee for an Independent Canada? I think you skated right over that. It was a miserable failure, wasn't it? I mean, yeah. You just went down the tubes and you've never really come back.
I guess we did two important things. And
what
it
happened?
It wasn't a failure. It was a great success. Thing number one is that we told Canadians about some of the harms and some of the damages of foreign control of our economy. And thing number two is when we started, foreign ownership was going like this. And when we finished, foreign ownership was down like that. There was a huge difference. When we closed the doors,
were you the ones
on
who
the CIC market, foreign ownership was down to 27%, a big difference.
Were you responsible for FIRA? I mean, can you take some responsibility for that plan? The Foreign Investment Review Agency?
I would say to you without the slightest hesitation that FIRA was a very poorly thought out policy. It was very poorly managed. No, I think it was, it didn't address most of the problems relating to foreign ownership in
Canada. You're prepared right now to heap loads and loads of praise for Investment Canada, Mulroney's new successor to FIRA, right? Good plan. Get Americans.
Between 9 and 10 this morning, while the people of British Columbia are watching this show, $1 million will leave Canada in interest payments, mostly to the United States. $300,000 will leave Canada in that same hour in dividends, mostly leaving to the United States. $800,000 will leave Canada during the same hour in monkey business service charges that American corporations charge their parent, their subsidiaries here in Canada.
And that's bad.
Now, if you want to have the policies of Mulroney's government, you're going to bankrupt this country. It's no accident that Canada has the highest amount of foreign ownership and, at the same time, the highest amount of unemployment of any industrialized nation. They're very closely related.
So what's your plans? I'd like to just get a sense. Yeah. You're back in town tonight. You've got address, Mel Hurtig tonight, one-man show.
Talking at the Robson Square. There'll be others there as well, some well-known Canadians as well, at 8 o'clock. One of the things I'll be talking about, and I couldn't believe the answers from the gentleman from the C.D. Howe Institute. I couldn't believe them. That kind of policy results in high interest rates, the kind of policies that he's talking about. Interrelated with the United States, we've got to stick with American high interest rates. Look, one of the biggest reasons we have so many small and medium-sized businessmen across this province and across Canada going down the tubes and millions of Canadians out of work is because of the high interest rate policies. You continue to depend on foreign investment in Canada, and you've got to have high interest rates.
But interest rates aside, maybe it's just a fact of the Canadian reality that we're the tail of the American dog. It's a giant. It's 10 times the size of Canada in terms of population. Maybe we just have to learn to live with the American reality of an economic power and find our identity or whatever in some other way.
That's a very nice statement to make. But when you live next door to a big neighbor who's got a house 10 times bigger than yours, there's no reason that you have to sell them your bedroom and your living room and your dining room and your garage and your bathroom as well. You can have a good trading relationship. You remember, and Canadians really need to know this, there are millions and millions of Americans in the United States who are dependent on jobs that depend on exports to Canada. You know, they're very dependent on us as well. Mm-hmm.
I need a list of some of the big shots that you say that you've got backing you up this time. I remember in the past you had people like Walter Gordon, Mavor Moore.
Walter Gordon will be there. David Suzuki will be there. Pierre Burton will be there. Margaret Atwood will be there. Margaret Lawrence will be there. There'll be businessmen like Paul Martin Jr. from Montreal and Bob Blair from Nova Corporation and Jack Bedell, the president of Clarkson & Company. Not tonight. These are people who are in our organization.
You've got these people lined up.
Yep.
We'll take your calls. Do you think that it's time for renewed Canadian nationalism, wave the economic flag, and your calls to Mel Hurtig right after the break? We're going to go to calls now. I've learned a few things from Steve on punching the phones, but you're going to have to hang with us. By the way, how's your encyclopedia going? You've got some magical plan for a three-volume all-Canadian encyclopedia.
Color separations were recently done in Vancouver. The first pages came off the presses in Montreal last week.
How's sales going?
Looks good.
So strike one blow for Canadian identity there.
Oh, it's it's a good step in the right direction.
Hey, you're from Edmonton. You've got the cruise missile whizzing right over your head, don't you?
A lot of people in Edmonton are concerned about it. A lot of Canadians should be concerned about it because it just involves us more in the escalation of the nuclear arms race. One of the important aspects of our new organization, we'll have representatives from Project Plowshares there, Project Dismantle, and Operation Dismantle, and other organizations. We do not want to get too involved with the American military-industrial establishment.
Yeah, but there's
we
money.
Think Canada can play a major role in de-escalating the tension between the nations of the world.
But what does that say about the Canadian personality? Because New Zealand and Australia are also Western world allies of the United States. They say, we don't want your weapons in this country. We don't want them tested here. Whereas Canada says, well, it's part of our alliance with the United States, so therefore we must allow the cruise missile to be tested here.
Look,
what does that say about the Canadian personality?
I'll tell you what it says. It says that sometimes we have lousy governments. The overwhelming majority of Canadians are very much in favor of a nuclear freeze, and yet our government was one of the few countries recently at the United Nations that voted against a nuclear freeze. Why? Because as long as you have to go down cap in hand and bended knees to argue for favorable treatment in Washington, or gee, we need more U.S. investment, you're always going to have a non-independent Canadian foreign policy.
But let me put it to you this way. $25 billion just for one military program alone, Star Wars, the Strategic Defense Initiative, we could get some of that money. We could create some jobs here. I mean, you can't really gainsay that, can you?
Every study that's ever been done into job creation shows that if you spend $25 billion in arms creation, you'll create twice as many jobs in social services or in manufacturing or other kinds of industrial development as you will in spending it on arms.
Let's go
okay,
to the
yeah, I'm
going to
try this right now. This is an experiment. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, good morning. I'd like to compliment your guest there on his insight.
Thank you.
Take off your hat.
I'm a little annoyed with the naivety of you two reporters when it comes to viewing the amount of American control in Canada and other foreign controls. And I also think that everybody essentially is looking for a free ride. Nobody wants to work for the some good of the country. It seems that everybody's seeking the easiest way out. If it comes to shipping money across the border, so be it. I think when you commented on morality and used another term, which doesn't come to mind, one of the reporters was laughing at it.
Oh, loyalty, I said. I said, wasn't it disloyal to trade in Canadian currency?
Okay, disloyalty, and I thought maybe the other, out of the words of one of the, your co...
I said that there may not be any sense of morality in money markets.
What do you think? Do you think it was disloyal? Do you think it's
I think there's a more important question. You guys are all sure that we've got to have this foreign capital. Gosh, what would we do without it?
I'm just playing the devil's advocate. I don't really believe that myself.
Let me address a point to every small and medium-sized businessman in this province who's had trouble with the big five Canadian banks in the last few years, putting them out of business, putting pressure on them, failing to lend them any money. Our big banks are lending 60 to 65% of all of their loans to big foreign corporations. No wonder Canadian businessmen can't expand. No wonder Canadian businessmen have to lay off workers. It's about time our banks acted in a, not in a sense of morality, who would expect the banks to do that, but in a sense of what is called the national interest.
Our own interest. Go ahead.
Gentlemen, Mr. Hurtig, I'd like to ask you what our standing is on our import-export trade deficit, and here's a little comment I'd like to make. I think for too many years we've been selling out for instance, scrap material to Japan at penny for the pound, you know, penny per tons, and we're paying dollar per pound by the time we get it back in the form of cars.
Exactly.
Sounds like you've got a member here. What do you think about
is right. And Stuart Smith, the head of the Science Council of Canada, said the other day one of the biggest problems is we're relying on exports, but we export the raw logs, for God's sake, from British Columbia, and we import, what do we import? Labor-intensive goods.
I'd like to try this. Does anybody want to give Mel Hurtig a hard time? Kelowna, do you want to say something nasty to Mel Hurtig?
Mr. Hurtig.
Sir.
How can we ever expect to compete against the U.S.? I think we have to accept them as partners. You know, my goodness, we have way more land area than they have, and we have a population less than California. Yeah. I don't see how we can ever build up a wall.
Well, the point is, you accept them as partners, I guess. But not necessarily as dictators.
Look, there's nothing wrong with the occasional joint venture. I would love to see us start a brand new automobile company mm-hmm. here in Canada with 51% ownership, Canadian ownership, 51% Canadian control, and maybe bring in a Japanese company or a West German company or an American company, as long as the key decisions and most of the benefits are made in Canada and go to Canadians.
Let me ask you, in your business, do you have American partners?
We sell to the United States.
But you have American partners in your
business. I don't have any American partners, of course not.
What about this new book? Have you heard about this new book that's come out, written by an American, a New York Times reporter, who says, who concludes that Canadians are basically dull?
Yeah.
Well, look, that's another fault of Canadians. When you have great Canadian people like Jack Webster, for
Mark
God's
Schneider,
sake, would you
Steve
call
Wyatt.
Jack Webster dull? I mean, any Canadian who pays attention to that kind of garbage from the United States probably should move down to the United States.
Okay, next. Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Well, I would interested in Mr. Hurtig, and I would have to say that you use the word dull in describing the Canadian people, and I use the word dull when I'm listening to Mr. Hurtig.
Is your dull?
I would have thought.
Pull him off the stuff.
Considering what has happened in this country in the last two or three years, that Mr. Hurtig, you must realize that you can't balkanize this country and separate yourself.
I've been complaining about the balkanization of Canada for years by our provincial premiers. Is that what you mean?
This kind of fellow is a person that goes around, and I don't know, I suppose he lives
like
off of this.
I don't think
you
so.
You know, he talks nonsense. That's all it amounts to.
Okay, you got your point in. Line five. Go ahead.
Yes.
Hello.
My question is to you, Mark. You seem to favor foreign investment in Canada.
I was just playing the devil's advocate. That's what I'm supposed to do here. You know, you can tell I'm kind of faking it here, and I thought that would work. Obviously, it's got you irritated. Do you have a point for Mel Hurtig?
You seem to have the idea that it will create work for your children.
Well, I don't know what's going to create work. Mel doesn't think so. Ted Carmichael of the C.D. Howe Institute said it would.
Look, let me tell you a quick story, and I appreciate your comments. Let me tell you a quick story. The other day I had a meeting with a bank president, an assistant bank president, a house builder, a furniture dealer. It was a private lunch for about an hour and a half, and we said, hey, what are you going to do in 1985? Not very much, not very much. Why? Because of high interest rates. If you follow the policies of the C.D. Howe Institute, you're going to end up with high interest rate policies in Canada, and I say that is not what should happen in this country if you want medium and small Canadian businessmen plus big businessmen to go out and create jobs for Canadians. Instead, what the Mulroney government wants is big foreign corporations to come in and supposedly create jobs for Canadians. They're not going to do that. They're going to create people who buy parts and components for their parent from their parent companies. I'll make one last point because you've got lots of callers. Foreign corporations in Canada import four times as many goods and services from the United States as do Canadian companies. They're importing jobs created in other countries that should be created here in this country.
Okay, well, thank you. I don't know if I'm convinced. Are you convinced?
I'm going to sit on the fence. I'll be a real Canadian in that.
Let's plug you're giving your one-man show tonight. Let's see where it's happening. Coming up, Robson Square.
Near Robson Square tonight,
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock, and the public is welcome, and we'll talk about the formation of a brand new pan-Canadian organization.
Oh, do you have a name? Let's get the name.
We don't have a name
called
yet. It'll be something like the Association of Canadians or the New Canada Association. We're looking for suggestions for a name, and we
there it is. Mel Hurtig tonight, Robson Square Media Center, 8 p.m., 682-6331. Whose phone number is that?
It's a good friend in Vancouver.
Aha. Okay, Mel, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you, Mel.
My pleasure.
Steve.
And after the break, we're going to meet Heather Bird, who is a newspaper reporter in Saskatchewan, has written an incredible book on the Colin Thatcher murder story. She'll be here after the break.
I am innocent. I did not do it. But it wasn't in the cards, and no, I will not be appealing.
Did you get a fair trial, Mr. Thatcher?
I'm innocent, so I don't.
It must have been one of the most spectacular murder trials in our recent history, that of Colin Thatcher and the murder of his wife Joanne Wilson. In January 1983, he was charged with a murder in May 1984 after a long, convoluted story about custody battles, all sorts of things. And in order to refresh your memory about what happened to Colin Thatcher, the former energy minister in the Saskatchewan Tory government under Grant Devine, we've put together a quick little piece on tape just to show you the stages of the events and what happened, beginning with his arrest and the charge of murder.
May 7th, 1984, members of the Regina Police Service arrested and charged Wilbert Colin Thatcher, age 45 years, of Moose Jaw with first-degree murder of his former wife, Joanne K. Wilson, aged 43, of Regina.
Addressing a five-woman, seven-man jury, Chief Crown Prosecutor Sir Cuyava said he will present evidence that Thatcher attempted to hire a farm neighbor to kill his former wife. Cuyava claims the neighbor refused, but did supply guns, ammunition, and cars. The prosecution also maintains Thatcher admitted to a former girlfriend after the murder that he killed his ex-wife. The first witness, Regina Police Constable Brian Frickland, testified a credit card receipt from a Karen, Saskatchewan service station was found at the murder scene. It had Colin Thatcher's signature, but Thatcher's fingerprints could not be found on it. A passerby, Craig Dotson, testified he was attracted to the Wilson garage by screams, only to find Mrs. Wilson's body and a bearded, long-haired man leaving the scene. Thatcher's housekeeper, Sandra Silversides, testified that Thatcher arrived at his Moose Jaw residence around 5:30 and joined her and his two sons for supper. She said they ate at 6 o'clock, just like they did every night. That was the time the court had been told that Joanne Wilson was murdered 70 kilometers away in Regina. Thatcher's lawyer, Tony Merchant, lives only a block away from where Joanne Wilson was murdered. He testified that he learned of the murder within 15 minutes of it happening and immediately placed a call to Thatcher's Moose Jaw home. He said Thatcher reacted by saying, "You've got to be kidding." Cuyava told Thatcher, "You gave us a great long story on how you had been the perfect husband in the final days of your marriage." He suggested Thatcher was in Palm Springs during that period, having sexual intercourse with the secretary, Janice Gardner. Thatcher admitted it, saying he had human frailties. Cuyava then accused Thatcher of using his 10-year-old daughter, Stephanie, by having her sit in the courtroom. Thatcher replied, "I don't understand what you mean." Cuyava went on to call Thatcher the J.R. Ewing of Saskatchewan, whose testimony in part resembled Grimm's fairy tales.
Colin Thatcher has been found guilty of first-degree murder in the January 1983 killing of Joanne Wilson, his former wife, with whom he went through a bitter separation, divorce, and child custody battle, which began in 1979 and ended with her death 4 years after. Mr. Justice J.H. Maher sentenced Thatcher to the mandatory life imprisonment. He will not be eligible for parole for 25 years.
Are you going to appeal, Colin?
No, I'm not going to appeal. It doesn't matter now.
It doesn't matter? Have you given up, Colin?
I am innocent. I did not do it. But it wasn't in the cards, and no, I will not be appealing.
Did you get a fair trial, Mr. Thatcher?
I'm innocent, so I don't know.
This is the book, Not Above the Law, by Heather Bird, who is not a reporter from Saskatchewan, but from Toronto and with the Toronto Sun. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Look, this is an amazing story. I mean, it startled everybody in the country for months while that trial was going on. We just heard him say that he was innocent. What do you think?
He's been saying he's innocent all the way along. I think he's guilty. I think the jury came to the right decision. I think when he said that he wasn't going to appeal, what the problem was at that point, you're so devastated, I imagine, right, you have another human being saying you're going to jail for the rest of your life. And I think after he cooled out, after he thought about it, talked to his lawyers, he realized that he should go ahead with it.
And he's going to appeal now. Where is he being held?
He's being held in general population in the federal penitentiary near Edmonton.
He's not being isolated from the rest of the prison population.
He's being treated like everybody else.
How's he making out in there?
I've heard that he seems to be making out okay. And ironically, he was in jail along with Cody Crutcher, who was one of the fellows who was implicated. Cody didn't testify, but his buddy Charlie Wilde said that Thatcher offered the money to kill Joanne.
Tell me something about Colin Thatcher. Here's a man who had everything going for him. He was the son of a premier. He had money. He had opportunities. He was a cabinet minister in Grant Devine's government. Tell me something about him. What kind of man was he? Is he?
He's almost two different people. You're right. On the upside, he can be charming, witty, articulate. He was a very able politician. He represented the people of the Thunder Creek riding very well. His ex-girlfriend, Lynn Mandel, tells me he could be tender and romantic at times. Mm-hmm. And then on the downside, he's arrogant, volatile, violent. He's beaten up Joanne, that's documented in the divorce case, black eyes. He beat up Lynn Mandel several times, that's in the book. And he'd like to get his own way.
It's incredible. Tell me something about these, can you talk about these custody battles that were going on for a brief time without...
Oh, it wasn't really a brief time. It went on from the second. Like, it started off when she left, she took the kids. She skipped, she moved to Brampton, and they settled there. He came back across the country, tracked her down, and stole the kids off the street, took them back. And that started something that went to the Supreme Court of Canada and wound up with him being charged with contempt, found
How long had they been married, Joanne Wilson and Colin Thatcher?
17 years.
17 years. And what was her reason for leaving in the first place? Did she ever get
You know, it's funny. When I interviewed her dad for the book, there was an instance in 1977 where he was in the government. He was coming home quite late, 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. He'd been drinking. And she confronted him with it. He said, you know, this has got to stop. And I believe at that point they also had an argument because he accused her of giving him venereal disease. And this is when the fight ensued. The stories are very different. She said that he punched her in the face, blackened both her eyes. He said that he rolled over quickly in bed and hit her with his elbow. Mm. And at that point he said to her, if you don't like the way things are, you can leave. Mm. And her father later said that was the point where she made up her mind. You know, it broke her heart, and that's what her dad said.
What was the relationship between Colin Thatcher and his in-laws? Was there some
There were some problems there. You see, initially, Mr. and Mrs. Geiger are a small town in Ames, Iowa, you know, God-fearing middle Americans, and they're even today hard-pressed to say anything bad about Colin Thatcher. Initially, they liked him. They knew that he was somebody special. Right. That was his daughter. But as time went on, they stopped going up to visit her in Saskatchewan because they felt that every time they went, Colin would use them to get at her. And her dad said he used to needle her all the time, and we finally stopped going because we didn't feel comfortable.
It's almost as if he was living kind of a secret life, doesn't it? Like this other side of him that was kept away from the public view. And
I don't know. I think people in Saskatchewan knew for a long time what he's like. The stories and the rumor mill about the way he behaved and the way he treated people, it was fairly common knowledge.
More on this fascinating story with Heather Bird after the break. Heather Bird has written a book called Not Above the Law. It's the story of the Colin Thatcher murder of his wife Joanne Wilson. Tell me something about this custody battle. I remember when the conviction finally came through, all these stories came out that allegations that Colin Thatcher had actually deliberately tried to turn his children against Joanne Wilson in really kind of a brutal way.
That's true. In the custody thing, that it's documented in the divorce proceedings that you can find in the Regina Courthouse, the judge himself says, seems to me that Mr. Thatcher has deliberately tried to turn his sons against his daughter, that it's not working with the little girl. But he said that they used to sit around at night and Colin would sit down with the boys and say, we're going to do this to her and we're going to do that. And he made it like a team effort, us against her. He used to call her the bitch all the time and called her terrible names in front of the boys. At one point, he called her... He put a notice up on the fridge outlining the fact that somebody was ordered to pay money because this woman had had an affair with another man. And that's what was a problem in it. She had had an affair with Thatcher's best friend.
It's almost like kind of a systematic bashing, almost mental bashing.
That's right. Yeah. And the judge said that it was a poisonous thing to do, and that Thatcher said, well, I kind of put the note up as a joke. And the judge said, well, if it was a joke, it's not funny, Mr. Thatcher. Yeah. We're not impressed.
Was there ever any evidence that the children, the sons, actually committed any kind of physical aggression against the mother?
There was a problem when Gregory, that's the oldest boy, was 14. Joanne had gone to the house. She was going to get Stephanie, the little gal, and take her out. And Colin had made this ruling, nobody takes any children out of this house while I'm not here. And he made that very clear, and then he went out. So when Joanne showed up to pick up her daughter, she had a physical fight with her son. Now there's two sides. Greg said his mom started it by stepping on him, and she said that he pushed him. At any rate, it was a very bad scene, and she ended up leaving the house with the bruises on her face.
What about Joanne Wilson? Tell me something about her background. Where's she from?
She's from Ames, Iowa. Her mom and dad always thought that she'd end up in New York or St. Louis or something because she had showed a real flair for design. And they felt like she'd be a buyer in a big department store. So they were really surprised when she went north to Saskatchewan and settled down in Moose Jaw.
How did they meet?
No, it's actually ironic because Colin was sitting in the student activity office at the Iowa State University. And a blonde woman walked by, and he said, well, who's that? And somebody said, oh, that's Joanne Geiger. And because of the fraternity sorority system, it's easy enough to set up a blind date. So he went to pick up this girl he saw, and it turned out it wasn't the same girl. Joanne Geiger was not the woman he was initially attracted to.
Oh, I see.
They went out, and they had their date anyway, and it went from there.
Now, was this a first marriage for him, or this is
First marriage for both of them.
Right, okay. Tell me, the actual murder in the garage, there's some confusion, was Thatcher actually there,
or did someone else do it for him?
It's a legal point. Under the first-degree murder charge in the Canadian Criminal Code says you're equally culpable of homicide if you actually do it or if you cause, pay somebody to do it. Mm-hmm. And the judge told the jury in his charge that you have to decide one way or the other. And we'll never know what the jury decided. But it seems to me, and I say this because it was such a brutal killing. It's something, he beat her for 5 or 6 minutes and then he shot her. I don't think a paid killer would spend the time. It belies like a hatred, a real intensity. And that combined with the fact that they found a credit card receipt 8 feet from her body with Colin Thatcher's signature mm-hmm. on it, sitting in a snowbank. It was dry. It hadn't been there very long.
Looking back now, do you think that there was ever any love between those two people?
Oh, they loved each other very much. They were very happy when they were early marriage. You know, she was very involved in the political scene. She gave up her career and then took bookkeeping courses to help him with the ranching and the farming. And she was actively politicking for him and his father all the time. It was a storybook marriage.
When did it start to go downhill?
It started to go downhill around 1977. That's when they had the initial scene. And in 1979, she fled.
It's hard to understand this strange competition for children. Because wasn't it the day after she was murdered that Colin Thatcher was charged with the abduction of his
Stephanie.
Own daughter?
Yes, that's right. Because her husband, her then husband, Mr. Wilson, had custody, technically had custody. And Colin went and got her. The charges, I believe, eventually were dropped. And he said later, you know, I've done what any other parent in Saskatchewan would do. Mr. Geiger, Joanne's father, told me the problem was is Joanne feared what might happen to the boys and the little girl if they stayed with Colin. Mm-hmm. In her initial affidavit, she said, I'm leaving him because I have to get the children away from him. The psychological damage of temper and mm-hmm. they're becoming isolated. They've got to start seeing other people.
And then he went on some long-distance flying trying to find them and something like that.
Oh, yeah, it was quite a trip because she didn't obviously let him know where she was.
Right.
And he was writing love letters to her in an intermediate, very passionate letters. You know, I love you, please come home, we need you. And he managed to track her down in Brampton only because the man she was with had her phone number and his wife found it. It's very complicated and gave it to Colin. And Colin then flew east and grabbed the children.
It really is an episode out of Dallas. As tragic as it is, it sounds like something that would be on television, a soap opera.
Exactly.
What's the attitude towards Colin Thatcher now in his home province?
They're polarized. There are people who firmly believe that Colin Thatcher is innocent, that Colin Thatcher has been framed, that he didn't get a fair trial. A lot of people believe the media convicted him.
What would give them that impression?
I think that because he was such a good politician for the people of Thunder Creek, and that's where I understand most of his strength is, they raised $14,000 for his defense fund. And
$14,000? This
$14,000.
Is a private citizens organization
that's
in Saskatchewan.
Correct. That's correct. And they see, but people are entitled to their opinion, and they obviously knew Colin Thatcher on a different level than mm-hmm. other people.
This is a gut feeling. Is it not really based on any evidence that might have appeared before the courts?
That's right. That's right.
Is this this defense fund that's still growing, is it still active across the country, and are they soliciting support?
I don't believe it's active across the country. It's certainly based in Saskatchewan. I understand their first meeting, they had about 300 people, maybe 350. But when I was in Edmonton yesterday, I heard that they do have a small chapter in Edmonton. They've got people in Red Deer who believe that.
What happened to his own wealth?
Well, an awful lot of it, he made bad investments for starters. Then beef prices declined. Then he was ordered to pay Joanne a great deal of money. And to do that, he would have had to sell some of his land. He didn't do it, but he's got outstanding lawsuits. He admitted this on the stand, and 3 or 4 financial institutions going after him for a fair bit of money.
How much do you know?
I don't know. It's specifically. I know one suit is for $350,000. Mm-hmm. See, he was always a millionaire on paper because of his land holdings, mm-hmm. not because he had it in the bank.
I see. More with Heather Bird and the Colin Thatcher story, and your calls to her as well after the break.
Not Above the Law, it's the story of Colin Thatcher and his conviction on the murder of his wife, Joanne Wilson, written by Heather Bird. Heather, what's happened to the children now?
The children are living with their grandmother, Peggy Thatcher, at the Moose Jaw family home. Greg has stopped going to school. He's actually quit university when his father was arrested, and he's running the ranch, running the farm.
Will they ever be able to lead a normal life after all this?
I think so. It's going to be very difficult for them. You see, they're bright and they're attractive, they're intelligent. I think the saddest part about this is their parents made the decision to live in public life. They didn't, but they're living with the consequences.
They're kind of victims to them.
They are victims, very much so.
Go ahead, please.
Both the same school where Joanne is teaching, the Delta.
I'm having a bit of trouble with this.
Walk home at lunchtime, stuff like that. And we found her very quiet, sort of reserved, a very, very pleasant person. And when all this started with the divorce and whatever happened after that, the murder, we were very, very shocked and dismayed at it.
Joanne Wilson was your teacher.
She taught the same school, but she wasn't my teacher. We used to walk with her back and forth to school, like, you know.
Okay. You know, that's exactly what the judges said in the divorce case, is that Shay felt Joanne would be the better parent.
She would.
Yeah. Because of her nature, because she was kind and warm and giving.
Did she never become bitter, though, with all these, after her learning about all these beatings and this?
She was afraid. Her husband said on the stand she was afraid. She was afraid every day and every night for her life, mm-hmm. up until the time she was killed.
Go ahead, please.
Oh, hi. The one thing that bothers me about it is, why was he convicted of first-degree murder when I read the papers here with the grisly murders and lots of proof? And at second degree, that always bothered me. What makes the difference?
What about that?
The difference between first degree and second degree is, first degree, you have to, it has to be premeditated and you have to have a motive. Second degree is a crime of passion, where you see something and you react immediately. But first degree, it has to be thought out. Somebody has to coolly sit down and say, I'm going to kill this person, and go and do it.
And it was a contract killing in this case. So, we're not really sure, are we, about that? Really?
Yeah, he tried to hire people several times, and they didn't work out. They took his money and then never killed her.
And there was one failed attempt.
And there was one failed attempt when she was initially shot in 1981.
And who, did they ever catch a person who did that?
They suspect it was Colin Thatcher. You see, Gary Anderson testified, I bought the rifle, I gave Colin my car, and Colin came back and gave me the rifle and the car back and said I shot her. Lynn Mendel, his girlfriend, said that Colin came in and said, well, I shot her, that ought to fix him. You know, that sort of attitude.
If you could sort of encapsulize the motive, how would you describe it?
There was a bunch of motives all rolled up. You see, there was the affair she had. He was very bitter about that. He said in the stand, I am bitter and very, very betrayed. It was my best friend. There was the custody fight. Both of them desperately wanted the children, and that went for a long time. And there was the marriage settlement. The court ordered him to pay her $819,000, at the time the largest settlement in Canadian history. At the time of her death, he was due to pay her another $87,500. Mm-hmm. Now, there was a clause in the contract that said if either party died, the payment was automatically deferred a year. So I think it was a combination of all these things. You have to remember, too, that week was a rough week for Colin Thatcher, because he had been bounced from Greg Devine's cabinet.
Bounced from the cabinet, yes, that's right, I remember that. Go ahead, please.
I'm just curious about this. I just heard today it was $819,000. What will become of that judgment that was between the two of them during the divorce proceedings? Are her parents eligible now for that amount of money, or will that be kept in the family, or what will become of that judgment?
Or her children,
well,
maybe.
Okay, what happened was, after she was shot initially, the $819,000, Mr. Wilson renegotiated, that's Joanne's husband, and they agreed on a payment of $500,000 over 5 years. Now, at the time of her death, Colin still owed her $350,000. Tony Wilson is trying to get it. Joanne wants $250,000 to go to Stephanie, $30,000 to go to her parents, and the remaining $70,000 to go to Tony, her husband.
Did Grant Devine's government suffer? Was it stigmatized by this whole thing, or has he managed to survive the crisis?
I think they'll survive, but I don't think it. You know, you can't really say. There's by-elections, I understand, coming up in Saskatchewan. They're actually looking for a nomination. The PC Party nominating somebody in the Thunder Creek riding. I think time will tell.
Colin Thatcher actually kept his seat for a long time afterwards, didn't he?
He did. There was quite a battle. There was, I understand, a lone liberal in the House who was preventing it from going through.
And his liberal connections would be with his father, who was liberal premier of Saskatchewan for some time.
I can't remember exactly. It's in the book, but he was in the late 60s until 1971 when he lost. And then Thatcher originally ran as a liberal, but crossed the floor in 1977.
Right. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
I read your book and I found it very interesting, and I followed this case, and the one thing that really surprises me, and I don't really understand it, is that phone call at 6:24 from Moose Jaw to Palm Springs to Mandel. I had the I have played golf with Mr. Thatcher in Palm Springs at one time, and he's not a very nice man. But I just wondered about that one phone call to Palm Springs from Moose Jaw at 6:24, and it's a lot longer than 24 minutes to drive from, how he could have gotten back to the ranch at that time really puzzles me.
What's the story behind the phone call?
Well, the story behind the phone call is it never really became an issue in court. And it wasn't something that the Crown ever put forward in the defense. It was alluded to, but it never became a real piece of evidence. You see, the Crown holds that you can do the drive from Moose Jaw to Regina if you pull out all stops and you go flat out, and then you park your car in the back and you run in the back door. Now, it could be that somebody else was on the phone to Palm Springs at that time, I don't know, because it never really came out. We never got the full details.
The book is called Not Above the Law, the tragic story of Joanne Wilson and Colin Thatcher. You're first off the presses with us. I'm sure there's going to be lots to follow.
There's another four books coming. Colin's writing his own book.
His
own memoirs.
Yeah, in prison.
That's right. And Macmillan is publishing one in the fall. And there's another three, and I don't know who's writing them. I don't know where they're coming from.
Okay. Thanks very much, Heather.
Thank you very much.
And I'll be back after the break. I'd like to thank all the viewers for bearing with Mark and I in this difficult day. I know that your condolences and ours as well here at the station go out to Jack. As I mentioned at the top of the program, his wife passed away overnight after a lengthy illness. I know that all our sympathies go out to him. And the show will carry on. We'll be back Monday with an important guest of the United States, Russell Shaver, who's going to speak on behalf of the government's position on Star Wars. And watch us at Monday, 9 a.m. precisely. Colin Thatcher murder mystery on Check at Midnight.